No matter who you are or where you live, your life is made better every day by processes happening in nature. So today, let's talk about ecosystem services. You may or may not have heard this term before. It's in the news sometimes. But for anyone unfamiliar, the 2006 Millennium Ecosystem Assessment defines ecosystem services as the benefits people obtain from ecosystems. Sounds simple, right? But honestly, that's a lot to unpack. I mean, people get lots of things from ecosystems, and not just the ecosystems that are local to each of us. One way to think about ecosystem services is to identify processes happening in nature, think pollination, the water cycle, carbon sequestration, etc., and then understand how those processes benefit people. The Millennium Ecosystem Assessment made this really easy by categorizing ecosystem services into four groups: provisioning services, regulating services, cultural services, and supporting services. Provisioning ecosystem services are definitely the easiest to identify. These are things that people can get directly from nature, like lumber from a forest or fish from the ocean. The list of provisioning ecosystem services is really long, so I bet you can think of a lot of other examples. Regulating services are processes that help us, like pollination of crops or carbon sequestration to offset the effects of anthropogenic climate change. There are also many lesser-known regulating services, like how coral reefs can protect coastal regions from flooding due to large waves or extreme weather events, or how wetlands contribute to water purification and reduce flooding. Cultural ecosystem services might be a bit harder to identify because they're not always tangible things we get from nature. This group of ecosystem services includes things like how monarch butterflies are important to Mexican cultural beliefs surrounding death, or how certain mountains around the world are considered sacred by indigenous peoples. Ecotourism, hiking, and hobbies like nature photography are also cultural ecosystem services. The last category of ecosystem services is the supporting services. This group is basically a catch-all for the rest of the processes operating within ecosystems that allow them to function and therefore provide us with all of those other services. These supporting services are some of the most basic functions of ecosystems, like photosynthesis or decomposition or soil creation. At this point, you can probably think of a huge number of ecosystem services that you benefit from every single day. But it's not just you. Every human on the planet relies on ecosystem services for their well-being, and those of us living in the Northern Hemisphere with higher consumptive habits demand even more from all of Earth's ecosystems. But I bet you can guess what I'm going to say next. At the same time that the human population is increasing and asking even more from ecosystem services, those same services and their corresponding ecosystems are in decline. In 2006, the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment found that between 60 to 70% of ecosystem services are declining globally due to unsustainable use or ecosystem degradation and loss. Since ecosystem services can act on a very large geographic scale, they should probably be considered public goods and managed differently from how capitalism treats other goods and services. But the questions of who owns land and resources, whose actions affect the health of ecosystems, and who loses access to ecosystem services once they've been degraded show that we're not doing a very good job of managing ecosystem services as public goods. For example, let's think about global climate change. Some companies, industries, and countries are using far more fossil fuels and emitting far more greenhouse gases than others, but we are all feeling the effects of climate change. And people living in certain areas of the world are actually experiencing the effects of climate change more strongly than people living in other places. Clean air and water, as well as other climate-related processes like precipitation, seasonal temperature variation, and plant growth, are all being impacted because these ecosystem services aren't being managed at the global level. A research paper from 2014 calculated that we are losing somewhere between $4 to $20 trillion in ecosystem services per year around the world. But some advocates argue that we shouldn't be putting a price tag on ecosystem services. There are fears that equating ecosystem services to dollar values could cause them to be treated even more like capitalist commodities than public services. And some ecologists worry that if we start putting dollar values on certain parts of ecosystems, the less valuable parts might get ignored. For instance, how could you put a price tag on enjoying a walk in the woods with your family, or the existence of an endangered but not directly directly economically useful animal species. Some ecosystem services are just difficult to quantify. The scientists who published that 2014 paper said that putting monetary values on ecosystem services is helpful because it allows us to understand the magnitude of their contributions to human society, and that this valuation won't cause ecosystem services to be treated like commodities, as critics fear. What do you think about this debate? I'd love to hear your thoughts down in the comments. Since this video explores the idea of ecosystem services as public goods, I think I'll do a follow-up video that looks at the tragedy of the commons and how different people approach the management of public lands and resources, so stay tuned for that. If you liked this video, don't forget to like it. If you didn't like this video, please share it with someone who would. And if you'd like to support The Roving Naturalist, remember to hit the subscribe button and the bell notification icon. Then go check out my Patreon page. You can also follow me on Twitter and Instagram. I am so happy to be back making videos for all of you. Fieldwork this summer was awesome, but also exhausting. In any case, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.